Every lithium battery on the market has to have a BMS, or battery management system. And at first glance, it's kind of a confusing topic, and clearing up the complexities of this is exactly what we're going to cover today in lesson number 2 of the Battery Basics playlist. My name is Nate, and welcome to the Explorist Life Mobile, Marine, and Off-Grid Electrical Academy. Let's get started. At its core, a BMS, or battery management system, is effectively just a traffic light for the battery. And the basically just does two functions. It allows the battery to charge, or it allows the battery to discharge. And if the battery falls outside of allowable parameters for charging or discharging, the BMS is going to disconnect the battery from the rest of the system, which is going to prevent any kind of like catastrophic failures or system damage or anything like that. Now, what we see here, just I think I'm a pretty visual guy, and so I like to see what a BMS looks like. And this is a Victron BMS. Every one of these batteries behind me, that SOK battery over there, Battleborne battery right there, Rich Solar battery right there, XPN 360 battery here, Epoch battery over there, they all have BMSs inside of them. Now, what do they look like? Well, I'm not going to tear any of those apart. That's not this kind of channel, but they look like this. We'll have it overlaid. It's just a computer board. It's just a piece of hardware that's inside of the battery that does everything that this does. It's just, you know, sort of set up a little bit differently, but at its core, like I said, the BMS is responsible for allowing the battery to discharge and allowing the battery to charge. Allowed to discharge, allowed to charge. So when is a battery allowed to charge? So a lithium battery can only charge under certain parameters. So it can only charge whenever the temperature is right. It can only charge whenever the voltage is correct. It can only charge whenever we're delivering a proper charging amperage into the battery. If you're charging it too fast, it's going to shut off and it's not going to allow it to charge. If the voltage is too high or it's too low, it may not allow it to charge. Now, usually if it's too low, that means that the battery is just discharged and it has it built into the software to where it's going to allow it to start recharging. But if we've discharged it to a critical level, it depends on how the BMS is sort of set up. All of these, if with the internal batteries here, if you drain them to such a degree, they're going to shut down to like, you know, 2 to 3 volts or something like that to prevent any kind of damage to the actual cells of the battery. And to recharge them, more or less, you just have to hook it up to a charger that's connected to shore power, and it's going to force some power back into the battery, and it's going to get it back up to a chargeable voltage, and then it's going to charge from there. Now, if your charger, it has to see an actual chargeable voltage, then it can kind of leave you stranded. This is the case with sometimes with DC to DC chargers or solar charge controllers. If they don't know what the voltage is or they can't see a chargeable voltage, then they're not going to charge that battery. Now, the last way a battery can fall outside of allowable to charge parameters is temperature. If the temperature falls too far below parameters, it's not going to charge. If it goes too high, it's not going to charge. Now, a battery, a lithium battery in general, it depends on the manufacturer, but in general, the batteries can be charged as long as they're above freezing. So as long as they're above 32 degrees Fahrenheit, that's a general rule of thumb. They may differ a little bit depending on the manufacturers. Every manufacturer has its own sort of allowable like tolerances on that, but that's sort of the general rule of thumb there. Now, if it falls below 32 degrees, it could still discharge, which we'll talk about in a second, but it just won't be able to charge. So we're going to have to find a way to warm the battery up in order for it to be able to charge. But the BMS, whether that's the external BMS like one of these here or the internal BMS, is responsible for disconnecting the battery from everything, from allowing that charge to happen. Now, on the flip side, a lithium battery, it also can't discharge under certain parameters. So first one's going to be same thing, temperature. If the temperature falls below 0 degrees Fahrenheit, so if we're real cold, the battery can't discharge anymore and it's going to shut down. So there's a range between 0 degrees Fahrenheit and 32 degrees Fahrenheit where the battery might be able to discharge but not charge. But then if it gets even colder, it's not going to discharge. And same thing on the upper end. I don't recall what the numbers are because we typically don't reach the high end of the range in most applications, but I think it's somewhere in the ballpark of like 140 degrees Fahrenheit. The BMS in the same realm is responsible for shutting the battery down for charging and discharging whenever those inappropriate temperatures are reached. For voltages, it's the exact same thing. If a voltage falls outside of those allowable voltages for, you know, a 12 volt battery, if for some reason a battery falls too low, it's not going to allow it to discharge any further. Like I said with these just a second ago, it's going to go down to, you know, 2 volts or something like that. That's because the BMS has disconnected and it's just not allowing the voltage of the actual battery cells itself to fall even further. The cells are going to stay at a safe level to prevent any kind of damage, and that's because the BMS is not allowing the battery to further discharge, which would damage it. So current or amperage, if we try to discharge and pull too much power from any of these batteries, like it's a short circuit, or if we have too big of an inverter connected to too few of batteries, the BMS is not going to allow that. So I don't have all the different BMS outputs memorized, but let's say that I do know it for the Battleborne battery, wherever that is, there it is. So I know the output of that battery, it has a 100 amp BMS in it, which means that it can put out 100 amps at any given time. If we tried to pull 200 amps from that battery, that BMS is gonna say, whoa, that's way too much. We're just gonna go ahead and disconnect, shut down, so we don't damage anything. So when it comes to BMS outputs, even a manufacturer might have different lines or lines of batteries that can put out more or less power depending on the BMS. Epoch batteries, for example, they have their Elite line of batteries, which is this one here, and they also have their Essentials line of batteries, which it's the same capacity, but in the Essentials battery, the BMS is rated for a little less amperage output, which means it might not be able to power quite as powerful of an inverter as the Epoch Elite series batteries. So it's the same manufacturer, they just have sort of like a mid-grade line and then a premium line that have two different BMSs that are capable of putting out two different levels of power, and this is reflected in the price of the battery. So like I said at the start of this video, all of these batteries behind me have an internal BMS. And so the BMS in all of these batteries sort of acts as a valve, and you know it's going to turn on or turn off or only allow one-way discharging depending on, you know, the temperature, the voltage, the current, anything like that. Now, all that is handled internally inside the battery. Now, the Victron Smart NG line of batteries, it has an external BMS, and it basically serves the exact same function to a degree, but we're going to talk about how this works in an overall Victron battery system so that it makes a little more sense on how this particular device communicates and controls the battery output as well as its charging. So we have this system here that's been stripped down to a degree. If you want to know like full flow of power systems, we've already covered that in previous videos, so go back and watch some of the other Academy videos to get a good overview of what all these components are, because we're just going to cruise right through it. So down here we've got our two batteries, our Victron Smart NG batteries, and they're connected through data cables, which are these guys here on the side of the battery, to the Victron Lynx Smart BMS. Now the Smart BMS is going to control all of the other components in the system. So in a normally functioning system, everything is going to be working. The batteries are saying, hey, we're at a good temperature, we're at a good voltage, we're at a good amperage input or output, depending on if they're being charged or discharged. All is good to go. Just allow all the chargers and allow all the loads to function. So the smart BMS is going to be communicating through the different data cables in this system. So we've got the Link Smart BMS is relaying its information to the Victron Servo GX, which is sort of like the motherboard of this whole system. The Servo GX is then taking that information from the Link Smart BMS that's getting its information, remember, from the batteries and saying, hey, everything can charge, everything can discharge. So Servo GX is relaying that information here to the MultiPlus inverter charger and saying, hey, MultiPlus inverter charger, we're going to allow you to both charge and discharge because the batteries are at a great temperature, at a great voltage, and you're not pulling too much power, and you're not pushing too much power in either direction. Exact same thing with the DC to DC charger. From Link Smart BMS to Servo GX, Servo GX is telling all of the other chargers, the DC to DC charger here via VE Direct, and the solar charge controller down on the end via VE Direct. It's just sending all those data signals to those devices saying, hey, you can operate as normal. Where we sort of run into a little bit of a extra consideration is on things that aren't Victron components, like a standard 12-volt fuse block. So a standard 12-volt fuse block, there's no data cables or anything like that. It's not a smart device because there's nothing inside that can control inputs or outputs. So we have to put something in line to allow the 12-volt DC loads to pull power. So this is a smart battery protect, and it's getting its signals not from the Servo GX, but actually from the bottom of the Link Smart BMS itself. It's real small to see, so we'll have it overlaid right now, but there's actually a ATC port and an ATD port, and those are allowed to charge and allowed to discharge. And so we would be connecting those two wires from the allow to discharge port to the remote pins of the smart battery protect. And we're going to say, hey, you're fine right now because of all those parameters that we've been talking about, temperature, voltage, and current. So we're going to allow these 12-volt DC loads to pull power. And so that smart battery protect is simply bridging the gap. It's just a relay that's controlled by the Link Smart BMS directly, not even through the Servo GX. So what happens if, let's say, the batteries get too cold? Let's say the batteries get down to 10 degrees Fahrenheit. So that means that the batteries are going to be allowed to, allowed to discharge, but not allowed to charge anymore until they warm up to, you know, above 32 degrees Fahrenheit. So what happens is these batteries, they fall to 15 degrees Fahrenheit. They say, hey, it's getting pretty cold. We're not going to allow anything else to charge anymore. So, hey, BMS, tell the servo to tell everything else in the system, no more charging. We have to turn off all charging until we get warm again. So from there, data cables, BMS tells the Servo GX, say, hey, no more charging. So the Servo GX is going to communicate with the MultiPlus, say, hey, turn off your charger function. You can still have your inverter function live and working, but you have to turn off your charger function. DC to DC charger, we're just going to turn you off altogether because that's your only purpose, is to charge batteries. Same thing with the solar charge controller. It's going to turn off that solar charge controller because its only purpose is to charge batteries. If the batteries get even colder, we don't do any kind of heating or anything like that. We don't get the batteries nice and warmed up, and they fall to negative 10 degrees Fahrenheit. The battery is like, hey, I can't do anything now. I am way too cold. BMS, tell the Servo GX to cut off all loads. We're cutting off all loads and all chargers. Servo GX says, hey, charge controller, you're already out of the question. Orion XS, DC to DC charger, you're already out of the question. MultiPlus, the charger is already turned off, but we need you to stop inverting. We're going to turn you off altogether. 12-volt DC loads, hey, we can't really control you because you're not a smart device necessarily. That's kind of rude, but whatever. So the smart battery protect, we're going to say, hey, you need to turn off discharge to the 12-volt DC loads. And so that smart battery protect is just going to disconnect. And then from there, that's pretty much all there is to it. Everything has shut down appropriately to disconnect or reconnect the batteries, depending on those temperature ranges, any kind of fault codes, any kind of current that's being asked from or being put back into the batteries, or any kind of inappropriate voltages. Now, this is the Victron system and how this works, but you know, it's the exact same thing happening in all of these batteries. It's just happening at the battery level. So this, let's switch it up a little, that SOK battery over on that far side, it's not telling an external device that, hey, shut off this thing or shut off that thing. It's not handling it on a device by device level. It's handling it inside of the battery. So if it gets to 15 degrees Fahrenheit, it may turn its BMS into a one-way valve, and it's only going to allow power to go out of the battery, but not allow power to come back in. And if the power falls, or if the temperature falls even lower, then it's going to shut off that BMS altogether and not allow power to flow in or out. And so it can go from, you know, a two-way valve where power can go either direction to a one-way valve where it can only discharge, or it can go shut down altogether so that there's no power going in or out. And that's exactly how the SOK battery, the Battleborne battery, the Rich Solar battery, XPN360 battery, Epoch battery, and every other battery that we have at shop.explorist.life works in that regard. So there's two different sort of avenues to keeping lithium batteries safe with BMSs. Some you have a little more control of, some you have a little less control of, but regardless, once it's all set up and configured properly into an overall system design, like we specialize at shop.explorist.life, where we can get you the batteries you need, as well as a fully functioning system protected by proper BMSs, whether you go with batteries that have internal BMSs or external BMSs, we can help with any of that. So I hope this provides a little bit of clarity behind how BMSs work, you know, sort of behind the scenes to keep those lithium batteries safe and your system functioning properly. I hope this was insightful, and we'll see you next time.